I think Step Up is great in everything. Step Up is amazing in the fact that they accommodate to each girl's individual's needs. When you have a mentor, you sit down one-on-one and you're discussing what you feel. When I would sit down with my mentor, I would talk about my hardships, the things that I wanted, the dreams that I wanted, and how am I gonna accomplish? And you have that mentor right there pushing you and telling you, hey, you know, I went through these things, but there's other alternatives, don't give up.
Well, hello and good afternoon, everyone. Hope you're all doing well. Thank you for joining with us this afternoon. I hope, how can you not be inspired after seeing that? It's like, oh my God, like the music, Maria, it's just all goodness. I hope everyone's been enjoying the summit so far today. Just amazing. Just having seen this come together over the last few months and the amount of work and effort, it's just gone so seamlessly. So I hope you've had a chance to join some of the sessions. Thank you for joining ours. And please, there's more to come. I have to give the plug for the amazing Debbie Allen that's gonna close us out today. So I can fangirl over her. But again, thank you. I'm Tanya Garrett. I am a proud member of the New York Board for Step Up. I've been involved with Step Up for about 2.5 years. And this is just great to see us be able to come together as women, as allies, come together for the summit today. My day job, and I'm not working with Step Up on things, I work at LinkedIn. Most of you know LinkedIn is a place to find a job, but it's also a multi-billion dollar and growing advertising platform, of which I focus in that area. So today our topic, as you've signed up, is navigating the new you. I have myself and three amazing co-presenters and friends that will shortly introduce themselves. But our title today is not about us becoming something that we're not. It's really us leaning into things that we already are and how we can all support ourselves and each other during, I hate the term unprecedented times, but that's the word, that's the phrase, right? There's a pandemic, there's the global pandemic, there's the racial and social injustice pandemic, there's the political division pandemic, there is the climate change, thinking of our folks in the West, on the West Coast right now and the fires. There's a lot going on and economic uncertainty. So all four of us are here to give our point of views and some tips. We're not self-proposed experts. We want to share our thoughts. We want to hear from you. We have the chat, as Amanda has reminded everyone, please put in your feedback, your comments, your questions. We want to have as much dialogue as possible. We can see your beautiful smiling faces, most of you, and your Zoom outfits, which I love. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to my colleague, Juania, to introduce herself, and we'll get going.
Thank you, Tanya. My name is Juania Owens, and I am an investment manager team lead with the Department of Veterans Affairs. I first found out about Step Up last year, and I went to, I think it was maybe an end of year event when they were putting on a display of all the work that the girls had done throughout the year and the after school program. And I was so impressed with the girls and just the programs that you guys have put on, that Step Up have put on for these girls. And so I've loosely been involved with Step Up. And of course, Tanya being on the board, of course I had to join in today and like provide some sort of mentorship or, you know, just some words of encouragement. Like you said, Tanya, there's so much happening in the world today. And if what we share here can help bring a little light, I hope it does that for you. And with that, I think Kahshanna, you're next.
Okay, so hello, hello. I am beaming every single person who's watching this now and who will maybe watch in the future, especially those grads this year who have really headed into the most bizarre year that we have potentially ever shared in our lifetimes together. My background is in public relations, branding and marketing communications. I am the founder of Kissing Lions Public Relations. And prior to my time in communications, I have a background in fashion, film, television, and the entertainment industry. And then when I got a little bit of a burnout, which, you know, you'll hear a little bit of the insights I'd be happy to share today, I studied wellness for a good long while. So I'm really excited to be here. I've participated in startup events when I could over the last few years. And it's just been a love affair. I'm an avid supporter of making education accessible. There's just too many bright women X leaders of tomorrow that really deserve our nourishment, our energy, and we deserve each other. So looking forward to talking more about the exciting topics today. And I'm gonna roll it over to our next amazing woman, LaToya Christian.
Thank you, Kahshanna. So my name is LaToya Christian. I have had an opportunity to be a part of Step Up for a little over a year and a half. And Step Up was introduced to me at a time when I was looking for more meaningful connection and even a little bit more purpose, which I'll talk about at some point throughout our time together and share some tips in terms of how that manifested for me. During the day, I am a managing partner at GroupM. And I'm also just very thankful to all of you for joining, and also thankful to all of the other panelists, Kahshanna, Juania, and Tanya, as well as the women and individuals that step up that put together this amazing event.
Absolutely. And one last plug, LaToya, before you go on. For those of you who stick around toward the end, we do have some amazing door prizes and treats and surprises. So stay tuned for more on that.
Great, so we're gonna be going into a number of topics today, and we're all going to highlight and bring forth our insights and maybe even share some of our own experiences. As Tanya mentioned, you know, we are, you know, not here as therapists or any experts of any type, but we just feel as though there are so many insights that based on our experiences that we can share with you. So the areas that we're gonna be touching on today is self-care, which we know has become, you know, very prominent in our society, especially this year, as we really try to even navigate and figure out what does self-care look like during this time. We're also gonna be talking about relationships. I think it goes without saying that how we connect and how we engage with one another has truly changed and, you know, can feel a little disconnected, to be honest. So understanding that relationships matter more now than ever, even though it becomes a little bit more challenging. And then showing up for yourself. This is going to kind of, you know, finish us off for the afternoon. And we're going to be talking about how does that manifest, giving you tips and ideas of what that could look like for you. So moving to the next slide. You know, we wanted to ground ourselves in just what we were seeing. You know, we're all living during this time. And so we know how we're feeling. We know how we're experiencing things. And so even though it is very much we're having our individual experiences, we wanted to ground us in just the reality of, like, as a collective, we're not alone, right? Sometimes it can feel very isolating, like you might be the only one that might be feeling certain things. But just highlighting a few stats and the fact that, you know, during this time, you know, overwhelmingly more than half of people that are working are experiencing burnout. There is also that disparity in terms of, what we're doing in the home and even outside of the home, the hours between men and women putting in more hours than men. So just understanding that there is a disparity there. And so there's more work coming from the women's side. And then also just the reality of, you know, the fact that we're a little bit more disconnected. We can't engage and connect the way that we normally have in our community. So there is a growing feeling of loneliness across the country. So wanted to just highlight that even though we're feeling this, might be feeling it individually or even within our own homes, this is a collective experience.
Okay, unmuted. This is a really powerful time that we're in, but not just for the reasons Toya mentioned. Sorry, I've nicknamed her Toya, LaToya. So I wanted to talk a little bit about personal inventory. You know, what really motivated me in connecting with Step Up for this amazing panel today is that the reality is oftentimes we're having an experience and we're not always clear on when we can share, who we can share with. And sometimes we get so busy, we can't even tell how we are feeling, right? It sounds weird, but you know, once that New York minute gets a hold of us, or those of you in other demanding cities or in other demanding industries, it's like you can just feel like every Monday is like an SOS. So personal inventory is something that I stumbled upon several years ago when I was, during my former years, when I was in acting and being that fashion and personality. And, you know, it really is about slowing down and asking ourselves difficult questions, but having the space to see what happens once we allow ourselves to be honest, right? And so oftentimes it's trending to be mindful, it's trending to have a specific type of meditation. This is a little bit different. This is just about you and what's going on with you. So in personal inventory, you'll ask yourself things like, what do you do? You know, what would you like for self-care? When I say, Kahshanna, what would you like for self-care? Oh, I would really love a banana and strawberry smoothie. It's been a long day, right? So I already have begun this dialogue to really hear myself. If I'm doing new activities, or maybe even the same activities, I'll ask things like, is this even fun? Is this creative enough for me? Does this even feel good, what I'm doing? And when you look at that a little bit deeper, you think to yourself, what does my peace of mind even feel like during 2020? It might be very different than what it felt like previously. And the whole point of personal inventory is to ask yourself on an ongoing basis, right? You're not rushing to do it, but it's this expanded space, the safe space you create to really listen to your heart, your mind, your instincts. Oftentimes people say, listen to your gut. And ultimately, in a year that we've seen a lot of things change, a lot of the old ways are dying as social justice is emerging. And we've had to say goodbye to loved ones and friends. And ultimately, while there's not always a space in the professional realm to talk about those deeper topics, when you're doing personal inventory, which is just another version of self-care, you're able to ask yourself one question that has been one of the most important questions in my life. Do I feel safe enough to grieve? So if anyone wants to drop anything in the chat box about what question do you want to ask yourself today, or what question might you try asking yourself, you know, this week, feel free to drop it in the chat box. But I'd like to just take a quick moment of silence before our next slide. So all of you that are holding space for so many amazing Women X and girls, so many leaders of tomorrow, or maybe even colleagues and family members, let's just have that moment of silence together just to really honor everything we're doing to make sure we're checking in with ourselves and others. Getting some insight. That feels really good. Okay, on to the next slide.
I love that, Kahshanna. Some of the ways that I actually take stock in personal inventory is through writing and spending time in nature. So one of my favorite quotes is from Joan Didion. She said, I write entirely to find out what I'm thinking, what I'm looking at, what I see and what it means, what I want and what I fear. And I agree with the sentiment for so many reasons, because for me, journaling and writing, they've both been like consistent driving forces behind my growth as a human being. And it's a tool that I've used since I was a little girl and able to keep a diary. It helps me formulate my thoughts, like what you were saying, does this feel good to me? And opinions about myself and the world around me, and unpack complicated situations. And also record like some of my most treasured memories that I have from traveling or with my friends. And I believe that now, as we've said, I'm sure everybody's aware of this, even more so when there's so much civil unrest and we're dealing with the impacts of the pandemic, you know, whether we're alone or we're at home with a huge family, I think creating a regular writing habit and putting our thoughts and emotions that are running through our minds and our bodies into words could help alleviate maybe some of this anxiety we may feel, or even draw further attention to positive moments that we experience. So either way, something to keep in mind about writing and journaling, it costs us nothing. I mean, besides a pen, paper, and our time, but it is a tool that could help strengthen our minds and our immune systems. And I think the same can be said for spending time in nature. Multiple studies have been conducted, I'm sure if you Google, showcasing the benefits of being in nature, from uplifting our moods to improving our creative abilities. I live in New York City, so it's hard for me to get in nature as often. I have to actively drive to an actual forest to hike, which is one of my favorite things to do. But when I'm not able to do that, getting out for a walk along the water, especially after a long day, it helps me to clear my mind, release stress. And just the same with writing, I feel my most inspired when I'm out in nature. And I just let go of worries, the anxiety, the fears, anything that I'm feeling like tension, I just let it go. And in doing so, I usually end up thinking something of some creative idea or solution. And in our current situation, I think we could all use that. And just to intentionally, like Kahshanna said, that moment, give ourselves these moments of writing and having fun and being in nature, because they do help us cultivate our relationship with ourselves, our family, and our friends, and also how we show up for ourselves, which LaToya and Tanya will both delve into in a bit. So LaToya, we'll hand it off to you.
Thank you, Juania. So, love this quote by DVF, Diane von Furstenberg. The most important relationship in your life is the one you have with yourself. And I think that if you don't spend that time, so building off of self-care, spending that time with yourself and getting to know what serves you, what works for you, that is all great information for you to show up in other relationships and have other point of connection that can be more meaningful. So as we move to the next slide, we're gonna highlight a few items in terms of cultivating relationships that matter. As before, as I said, nurturing the relationship you have with yourself. You know, we are in, we'll emphasize again, we're in very, you know, difficult times, and depending on your responsibilities and your life stage, whether you're single or you're home or you're leading a team or you're looking for work, whatever it is that you're doing at this point in time, we're all in very different places. But the one thing that is very clear and consistent that I feel across whatever life stage or life phase you might be in right now is that you cannot pour from an empty cup. And what that really means is that we often spend so much time, you know, giving to others and doing for others, and it's all coming from a great place of intention and a great place of wanting to serve. However, if you continue to put yourself last, you're putting yourself in a situation that you're going to run dry, right? And so when you think about showing up in those relationships that are going to really be beneficial to you and really that you can feel connected in, you're not able to show up in those places and spaces the way you want to, right? Because you're pouring from an empty cup. So you cannot give what you do not have. And I try my best to really live with that and, you know, building off of the self-care, really allowing for that time and that space to make sure that I am nurturing myself before I show up in other relationships or other responsibilities that I might have. One of the other items that I personally have had to learn, I think it's a work in progress for your entire life, at least for me, I'll speak to that, be vulnerable and be willing to communicate. So I think there's a reality that right now, especially, there's this idea of, you know, everyone is going through a lot. Maybe I don't want to bother this person, or maybe I don't, they have a lot going on, so I won't call them or I won't text them. And so we act from assumptions. And the reality of it is, first, it's okay to acknowledge that you need to connect and you want to have, you know, opportunities to engage with people that you might miss, or people that, you know, maybe you're by yourself, you're single, and you don't have the opportunity to go to brunches and do all the things you used to do. Or maybe you're a parent and you're really trying to find outlets, you know, beyond just being with your family, to find ways to connect with, you know, those around you or those that you used to connect with, friendships. But I think the first part is even acknowledging that. And I think also communicating to those around you what you may need in terms of those relationships. I have this thing that I always say, like, no one is a mind reader. And there really is a need to kind of teach people what you need within your relationships, and really being okay with that. I think that there is a lot of time, going back to the assumption, we assume that that person can't be there, or we assume that, you know, they don't have enough time for me or whatever it is, but we haven't actually communicated what we need. And so I always say that communication and just being vulnerable and willing to say, this is how I might need you to show up for me, and then allow that space for that person to dictate if they can or cannot. But the first step is in acknowledging that. One of the other things that I've had to learn over the years, and I think I was reading a stat the other day that says, you know, once you hit your mid-20s, your relationships and your circles really start to change, and what they look like varies depending on what you're doing. And so one of the things that I've had to learn personally is that every relationship might not be the BFF relationship, right? Or, you know, understanding that even if you're with a partner, that you definitely need other relationships that are going to cultivate, that you feel like you can be cultivated in and nurture in other ways that really help to fill any aspects of who you are. One person will never be able to check all the boxes in terms of every single thing you need in a relationship. And this was a very strong opinion that I had. So if there are any other thoughts, definitely drop them in the chat. But, you know, I truly believe in the fact that it's okay to have various tribes and various points of connection with people, and, you know, understanding, you know, what that could look like from one tribe to the next. So you might have a group of people that are very much, you know, the parents, you know, that you go to for all things. And then maybe you have your group from college, and maybe you have your group from the workplace. And so just understanding that it really is okay to have various connections, various networks, various tribes, and realizing that each and every one of them may give you something different at this time, and really feeling okay with that. I do think that, you know, we think that it's only going to come in one place or show up in one way. And so for me, that was something that I had to learn to let go of a little bit. And I'll also tell you a little bit about how I came to step up. That's exactly how I came to step up, realizing that, you know, there was a desire for me to do more and lean into, you know, areas that I felt like I could have more purpose and feel a little bit more fulfilled, but then also realizing that I needed to expand a little bit. You know, I'll be very honest, there was a point in time I was all consumed with work. The only people I interacted with were people from work, and I knew that I had to expand a little bit more. And so being okay to make those connections elsewhere led me to step up. And this amazing tribe of women that you see me with today, you know, that became a network and a group for me that has also given me so much that I didn't even think that I needed, to be very honest. So just being open to that, I think, is one of the best things we can do with for ourselves. And then one of the last points is, during this time, connecting safely and with purpose. You know, we all know right now, the way we connect has to look different, and it has to be different just for the purposes of safety. And so if you can, you know, find that group, once again, going back to having various networks and various people that you check in with, you know, whether it is a phone call or a Zoom, I know we're all Zoomed out, but maybe you have those one or two people that you check in with on a week by week basis, or maybe even having what I like to call your safe social pod, where you know that there is a group of people or maybe other families that are adhering and aligning with what you feel is important right now in terms of safety and precautions. And so that is the tribe you stick with during this time. And that's how you find ways to socially interact, especially as we think about going into the winter. I know for me, that has been something that has been top of mind. How do I maintain connection? How do I make sure I don't feel so isolated during the winter months? So these are some things I'm actually putting into practice myself. And then also thinking about ways to align with causes. We're in a place where we are going through so much change as a society, as a country, and we're all, so many of us are looking for ways to show up and ways to make sure that we're pushing not only our country, but even our smaller communities forward in positive ways. And you'll also be very surprised that once you really dig deep in aligning with those purposes that matter the most to you, how you're able to connect with people that might be very like-minded or might be able to give you inspiration on how to better cultivate that. And then my last point in terms of cultivating relationships is a point of surrender. And I say that because I know there are a lot of ways in which we want to hold on to how we used to do things and how we used to connect and how it used to be. And I get extremely nostalgic. I miss my friends. I miss, you know, being able to connect with people in various ways. However, I do feel as though as we surrender and are open to the fact that it might need to look different, it might feel a little bit different, that once we let go of that resistance, there's a lot of opportunity and possibility in that. So if this resonated, you know, give a few reactions. But after that, I'm going to kick it off to Tanya.
There's a lot of great comments in the chat, and definitely we have our Q&A section, so we can circle back. I want to stay in my Erica Badu voice. How y'all doing, ladies? Everybody doing okay? I'm feeling, man, y'all good? Okay. Thank you for sticking with us. I mean, it's just amazing. From Kahshanna, Juania, and LaToya, just the comments, and these are just, you know, us as individuals and things we all talk about with each other. So we hope it's resonating with you guys. And for me, it's reminders and tips and things like for my own self, of self-care and cultivating relationships. And again, going to this quote, which we all know this, we hear it all the time, that how you show up for yourself will speak volumes when it's time to show up for others. You cannot, underline, fill up the cup of your neighbor or loved ones when you're depleted. Take care of you, take care of them in that order. And you've heard that theme resonated throughout today already. And it's easier said than done, because I feel like there's a lot of type A's on this Zoom, I'm just gonna call us out, that we wanna be control freaks and do everything ourselves and say, I got you and me and them and everybody, but you realize at the end of the day, you are depleted and it's difficult for you to maintain your own sanity, let alone those of others. So let's dive in of how we show up and honor ourselves. Next slide. So there's a lot on this slide. We'll go around the circle, and it's in a circle for a reason, because it's not a linear process and it's not a one and done. It's something continually to work on, to strive for. And I know I will say this over and over again, these are all works in progress for me. So when I think about, you know, showing up for myself and honoring myself, I never really thought about first and foremost thinking about resilience and strengthening my resilience. And like, what is that? I never thought about that. But again, it's a very overused buzzword in our vocabulary, but it is important to really understand and ground yourself in, let me be resilient. What does this look like? What does resiliency look like for me? Because when times get tough, I need some barometer of knowing, am I in it or am I in it? So I think just understanding through my own lens, how am I resilient? How have I shown up to be resilient? And being clear on that, I think that's a definite place to start, and something that I constantly have to do, because resilience doesn't always mean that I'm going to run a marathon. Resilience might be I'm going to get out for a walk for 30 minutes because that's all I can muster up to do today. So that's what resilience can take many forms. So I think once you start there and think about strengthening your resilience, you know, getting yourself grounded, it's really thinking about focusing on what you can control. That again is another thing that I struggle with. I mean, we've talked a lot about everything happening in our world, in our country, in our neighborhoods, in our homes. For those that have been impacted by the coronavirus, I mean, there's a lot. And again, we all can't get the cure for the COVID. We can't get the COVID, as my grandmother says. You know, we can't cure racism, we can't cure, but there are things that we can do to focus on what we can control on. For me, that's shown up of saying, I am very passionate about our political landscape right now, so I decided to be a poll worker. I'm gonna figure out how to do that safely. I wanna use this time wisely in my career, so I doubled down on things in my career that I wanted to were on my plan that maybe I doubled down on and said, you know what? Not later, now. I have the time, I have the focus, I'm not traveling, so it's a great time for me to focus on that. And then just ways of showing up for others, but then doing things like this, like Step Up. Our world is going crazy, but we have this wonderful organization like Step Up, and working with the girls and meeting other women, it's a great organization. So that's an area of focus. Again, what can I control within my own power? The other part within this showing up for yourself, mastering your stress, and I think we've kind of covered this a lot in terms of self-care and in terms of cultivating relationships. I am someone that I'm like, yeah, I got this. But then even with everything going on, I realized that my own mental and physical health was really suffering in a way that I just wasn't visible to me. I wasn't really being mindful of it, going, wow, I am more stressed. It's because no one's checking me. No one's like seeing me every day all the time going, are you okay? So it's easy to mask that stress daily if you're not interacting with people live. So I think it was important to kind of do the check-ins with myself, as Kahshanna mentioned. And again, I've used the word a lot of being gentle with myself. I think when we sometimes are in crazy times or saying we're gonna show up for ourselves, we come up with this like 99 list of things that we're gonna do and focus on, but it's about being gentle. And that again helps me manage my stress and being self-care, making time to take care of my mind and my body with my therapy, working out, and connecting with people. And I can't, even if it's with the Zoom sometimes, you know, whatever works in these crazy times. The other one, which I've seen some people mention in the chat, igniting the motivation. I know the early days when New York shut down, especially in March and April, I probably spent 95% of my time on my couch. If you ask me anything that was on Netflix, Hulu, Prime, I've seen it because I just withdrew. I really did withdraw. And just, it was just difficult. And I really was losing motivation. And I think, again, it was going back to self-care and cultivating relationships to reach out, to have some accountability, to say, I'm going to work out. I'm going to do this Peloton app, or let's get together for a social distance drink or coffee. Just some ways for someone to say, hey, I have not seen you. Where are you? So that was my way of giving you some motivation. And then sign up for other activities, as LaToya mentioned. Sometimes it's like volunteering, or I start being one of those annoying robocall folks, you know, for political things, like some accountability, but it helped give me motivation to make sure that I was doing something for myself and at least feeling like I was giving back. Because to me, when I give back, I feel like that helps me show up for myself. So that was important. And then the next one, which is one that I have really doubled down on a lot during this crazy time, of just remembering to be grateful. I've always grown up that way. We always, you know, wake up with my prayer and meditation time, but this really became a source of light and support for me of starting my day with three things I was grateful for. And there were some days I could have the pity party and I'm like, well, wait a minute, Tanya, you're actually being pity. You're having a pity party in your apartment, in a bed with a roof over your head, food, your health, yes, your distance from family and friends, but there's so much to be grateful for. And even in the toughest of times, it's important to remember that. I say it's like the Oprah moments, like, you know, it really does work. And it felt like it helped my mood and my emotional state to start my day that way and to end my day with that way. And encourage my friends to do the same. And then last but not least, again, not a linear, steps, but something that I continue to do and really double down on was seeking support. Again, going back to withdrawing, going within, being more quiet. I was very fortunate, one, to have a place where I worked at LinkedIn, offered a tremendous amount of support from my management team and leadership team to just my team, to my direct reports that were checking in on me and saying, how are you doing? What's going on? And that was amazing. And that was just something that was like such a gift. But also reaching out through my therapist, like reigniting that relationship and finding a new therapist. I think especially women of color, it's always a challenge of finding like a therapist that fits and works, but it's been such an amazing outlet for me and just helpful. Again, going back to accountability, to motivation, to just honoring myself and showing up for myself. So again, I think because of these things that I continually try to focus on, it's helping me to make sure that I have something to give to others, and hopefully I am being a better friend, a better daughter, you know, in all those different ways of showing a better manager, mentor, et cetera. So please let me know. It seems like there's some things that are like resonating with you guys, and I, you know, appreciate that. But and, you know, please let me know if there's other ways how you show up with for yourself and honor yourself that we haven't talked about. I want to get some new ideas as well. And I think we'll go into our general Q&A. All right. let's see. What questions? I'm looking in the chat. Anything that we haven't talked about? Ladies, we can all unmute ourselves. Let's throw out some things and see what folks are talking about.
So there are a couple of amazing comments in the chat box. Thank you, everyone, for just, you know, tuning in, sharing your insights. We talked a little, there's a couple questions about how can people really start choosing sort of groups that they can galvanize in, or what's the best way to approach interest groups, special interest groups for self-care? Do any of the panelists, or I can answer, I can start. So I think this is a great question. And doing that kind of snooping, there's a lot of private networks emerging surrounding our favorite topics, which I'm really excited about. So Mighty Networks, if you know any of your favorite authors on Mighty Networks, I'm actually a part of a lot of, you know, Chicks with Sticks, which are like crochet circles, which is like really, really fun. And these are amazing creatives. And this is just our way to sort of have our favorite, you know, glass of whatever it is and share and create. So there's Meetup, which I saw Janaea mention in the comments. Mm-hmm. So what about you ladies? What other ways have you found sort of specialty groups? Are you on WhatsApp special groups? Like give us a tell all.
Yeah, so for me personally, and Kahshanna, I know me and you had an opportunity to participate in this. So there is an amazing wellness group. It is a tribe of women that travel together, did retreats together. I was actually supposed to travel with this group in April. Mm-hmm. And since the pandemic, they have shifted to virtual. And so there have been a number of breathe sessions, yoga sessions, Saturday retreats where there are mindfulness experts, financial experts, all different types of people that are coming together on this platform in a very, very inexpensive way. I want to add that as well, to bring their specialty and then also cultivate community. And those communities have then turned into WhatsApp communities and things like that. And so that tribe is called Omnoir specifically. And then recently when you start talking to people and just start connecting with people, a book club, right? And so beginning to form connection through similar interests in what you're reading, what's important to you. So for me, those are the ways that I have been finding smaller communities to have my moments of escape or even differentiation from the people that I might talk to on a day-to-day basis, which is normally work, but outside of work.
Yeah, I know that it can be hard to find groups. And I actually, when I first moved to New York City, I created a book club. So I feel like too, if you can't find your specific circle, then maybe you create your own. I know it may be a little hard, but when I first moved to New York, I joined Meetup, and I was lucky enough to join like two groups that, you know, I still keep in touch with these people to this day. Like, they're some of my closest friends. And I also, through Meetup, that's how I created my book club. And I'm sure everything will be virtual now, but again, same thing. I feel like too, when I created that book club, I attracted the type of people who I wanted to meet and who I wanted to be around. And those relationships grew, like you said, LaToya, it grew from, okay, we're just meeting every Saturday. I can't remember the exact schedule, but we would read one book per month, and then it turned into brunch, and then it turned into movies. And, you know, we just actually developed a real friendship outside of the book club. So I will suggest, if you can't find your social circle, or if you are moving to a new place, then possibly create your own circle. And
I was gonna say, that was a perfect segue, speaking of books that both of you guys have mentioned, that leaves time for a giveaway, Kahshanna.
Okay, excellent. So can the book lovers that are here currently, if you are interested in some new inspiration having to do with self-care, feel free to drop something in the chat box, and the first person to drop, "I need that book," is going to get this first giveaway. So where are y'all at?
Okay.
Listen, I love it. Good grief. I'm not going to have any more caffeine for the day, because you guys just, you took me to the moon and back.
I think so. Julie was the first.
Okay. So this is really exciting. I'm holding, and I know it might be backwards because we are on Zoom. This is a very special book. I'm working with this amazing author by the name of Bridget Dengel Gaspard. And the name of this book is, drum roll, The Final Eighth: Enlist Your Inner Selves to Accomplish Your Goals. But what I really like about this book, which I've had the opportunity to read prior to the launch date, which is just next week, this really goes into, we can look at the different components of ourselves in that sort of open space that I spoke about earlier. So this is super, super exciting. We might have a couple more little giveaways, so please stay tuned. But Julie, make sure that you loop in with us. You are our winner. Congratulations.
Yes, you can DM me an address. That's great to send it to. And Kahshanna, put the name of the book in the chat so that
yes, I
can get that. I want to call out a question, because it's one of my favorite questions, and I know for fellow panelists as well. Someone asked about how to get over imposter syndrome when you start a new job. Love that kind of... yes, LaToya and I are in the same industry, so it's like, this comes up all the time. It comes up with everyone. And I'll kick it off, and I'm sure everyone's going to have a thought. And I'm just like, you got the job for a reason. You were there for a reason. You were hired. I don't care if you were faking it till you were making it. you were hired, and you're in the role. So for me, I've had that, and it's something that it always comes up even today. So even I was still like, wow, do I know enough? Am I smart enough? Am I such and such knows more? I think going back to some of the things we talked about, of really leaning into your strengths and understanding the things that you're good at and what you bring to the table, and really honoring that. I think in general, women always talk about what we've done, what the team has done. We never really focus on, what did I do? What did I bring to the table? And I had a manager a long time ago. She's like, I don't want you to hear you say we anymore. Not trying to be ugly or selfish, but tell me what you did, how you performed. And I was like, I started stuttering. I got nervous. I didn't want to do it. but it helped me understand, like, yes, I do have a lot to offer. I do bring a lot to the table. I am a contributing member of this team, and I'm in this role, and I'm going to rock the hell out of it. But I'd probably use another expletive in there, but not today. But ladies, what else do you have to say about that?
No, I love that question. For me personally, I'll speak about myself. That is something that I feel like it's always a work in progress. You always, I went to a program once, and we called them gremlins, right? You have these little gremlins that pop up every now and then that tell you what you can and shouldn't and won't do. And I think even going back to taking inventory, it also could be taking inventory of, what am I saying to myself? How am I speaking to myself? And I think as you continue to do that, as you begin to recognize that speaking, that how you're talking to yourself, you start to realize it's like, it's not even true, right? It's like when you really start to go like, is that true? Like you're saying these things and then you pause and you're like, but wait, is that really true? No, okay. If you feel like there is some aspect of it is true, I feel like it always comes from a place of this is maybe where you can grow. This is where you can learn, not necessarily from a place of deficit, which is what we focus on. So I would say the same aspect of doing inventory to practice self-care, also acknowledging and taking inventory in terms of what am I saying to myself and halting some of that negative speaking. My gremlin, her name is Roxanne. Apologies to anyone whose name might be Roxanne, but I named mine because I'm like, Roxanne, like, no, you have no space here. And so I think once you begin to recognize that, you're also able to stop it quicker. And over time, it will, the noise, the level of volume will decrease.
Well, I really love that, LaToya. And what I'd like to add here is that because I sort of come from a very different background, I didn't just start off my professional career being a corporate executive. It really helped me to actually, my job with a background in the performing arts was to actually go into and be in the shoes of different personalities within the construct of bringing high art to theater, right, or the performing arts. And it was a really helpful look in the mirror. So like LaToya, I have many sub-personalities and selves, but what I learned how to do through this sort of utilizing exercises that originate in voice dialogue, which is some of what's outlined in this amazing Final Eighth book, but it really allowed me a creative process to just, before I tossed anything out, I had to look and see what was there. And so my own process that seems to really work with me and that may work with other creatives is to really go into those guilt-free and make sure that you understand that you're protecting yourself within all these different inner voices that are happening. We've got an inner critic. We've got, you know, the sort of class clown that's always there during the work happy hour to make everyone laugh. So every single part of ourselves, in my philosophy, has a job. And the more we're clear about it, the more we can say, what is this inner critic trying to tell me? And oftentimes we're mimicking ideas and environments because those are intimidating us. And if they are harmful belief systems, if you are, for example, working somewhere where there is not equity, there's no 50-50, people of a certain gender or a certain culture are not getting walked through and able to have experience career succession, that's where those critics come in. It makes us nervous. And so those are things that we're seeing overhauled now. But really remember, sometimes it's not about self-blame or slapping yourself on the hand. It's about really assessing what environments am I in that voice of the environment has now been internalized.
That's great, ladies. Maybe one or two more questions and then a giveaway. And I know we have some wrap-up things before we end for our time. What else? Anything else jumping out? A lot of folks like that book. anything else, ladies, or any other questions or comments?
I can jump in with like another giveaway if
that please. Kind of go ahead.
So all right, I'm gonna be transparent because we have 12 minutes left. So has anyone felt the need for a little bit of beauty time, a little bit of skin self-care? So if you're a lover of beauty and skincare, feel free to drop it in this chat box. Yes. Oh my goodness. I see the yeses popping. So Tanya, yes. With your magic eye, can you tell me who was yes? Because I can't even follow this.
Gabriella?
Gabriella, yeah.
Okay, yes. Gabriella, I am so excited that you have won a Zen and Bougie self-love goddess box, and you'll be getting the nano version. Now, just to tell everyone how exciting this is, Zen and Bougie is a BIPOC-owned beauty and wellness brand that is plant-based herbs and nutrients for your skin that are also ingestible, and there's many fabulous products. But what I really love about Zen and Bougie is that it's created to support domestic violence survivors. And so we did talk a little bit about all the different communities that have been hit this year, but domestic violence has been a real shadow pandemic. So we celebrate the founder who herself is a domestic violence survivor, Shia Joyner, and be sure that you're in touch with us so you can get your self-love goddess box, and you're gonna be getting the nano box version.
Sounds exciting. Well, Gabriella, be sure to DM me an address that's appropriate to send it to, and we'll make sure you get it. Kahshanna, is that all of our giveaways?
Okay, we've got one more. So for you book—
Yeah, let's go ahead and do it.
Okay, so for you book lovers out there, and I'm feeling the magic. Now I can know I can just be loud now and be silly with you. Book, who just said the book? I think that's her. Mara. Okay, Mara, so thank you so much. Please stay in touch with me. We have some amazing complimentary things happening surrounding that book. So we're not gonna leave any of you behind. Lots of love, thank you so much.
Yes, and with that, I think we have a closing video or something to wrap up. Is there anything else at the end, Amanda, Amara? Yes, so thank you. So with that, just wanna give you guys a gift of a few minutes before you're going to your next session. Again, we just thank you for your time. For those of you that have been able to be here toward the end, or those who may be watching this on recording, you can connect with any of us on LinkedIn. I'm more than happy to connect with you to continue the conversation. I hope that all of you, if you're not involved with Step Up, will consider joining as a member or donating to this very worthy cause. It's a great program and really having impact on our young girls. And Women X. So with that, I will let you guys go off to your next session. Hope to see you in future sessions. And I will be in my living room dancing around to Debbie Allen.
Honestly, I deserve some credit. Okay, babe, let me go.